Luke chapter 8, verses 16 through 25. Are we there? Great. Verse 16, no one after lighting a lamp covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Take care then how you hear, for to the one who has more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks that he has will be taken away. Verse 19, then his mother and his brothers came to him, but they could not reach him because of the crowd. And he was told, your mother and your brothers are standing outside desiring to see you. But he answered them, my mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it. Verse 22, one day he got into a boat with his disciples and he said to them, let us go across to the other side of the lake. So they set out, and as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in danger. And they went and woke him, saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. And he awoke and rebuked the wind and the raging waves, and they ceased, and there was calm. He said to them, where is your faith? And they were afraid, and they marveled, saying to one another, who then is this that he commands even winds and water, and they obey him? Let's pray together. Thou great I am, we acknowledge and we confess that all things come from you. Life, breath, happiness, advancement, sight, touch, hearing, goodness, truth, beauty, all that makes existence amiable. In the spiritual world also, we are dependent entirely upon thee. So we ask, we give us grace to know more of our need of grace. Show us our sinfulness that we may willingly confess it, Lord. Reveal to us our weakness that we may know our strength is in you. We thank you for any sign of penitence. Give us more of it. Our sins are black and deep, and rise from a stony, proud, self-righteous heart. Help us to confess them with mourning, with regret, and self-loathing, with no pretense to merit or excuse, for we need healing. Good physician, here is your scope. Come and manifest your power. We need faith. You have given it to us to maintain, strengthen, increase it. Center it upon our Savior's work, upon the majesty of the Father, upon the operations of the Holy Spirit. So work in us now that we may never doubt you as the truthful, mighty, faithful God. Then we can bring our heart to you full of love, gratitude, hope, and joy. May we lay at your feet these fruits grown in your garden and love you with a passion that can never cool. Believe in you with a confidence that never staggers. Hope in you with an expectation that can never be dim. Delight in you with a rejoicing that cannot be stifled. And glorify you with the highest of our powers, with burning, blazing, glowing, radiating to yourself as your own glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So we're continuing on into Luke. Jesus is continuing his sermon, really, or his explanation of the parable that he just gave to his followers, to his disciples. And he's now bringing some revelatory application to the parable of the sower that we looked at last week. We saw that the seed, as Jesus declares in verse 11 of chapter 8, the seed in this parable of the sower is the word of God. And it falls on different resulting grounds or hearts. And dependent upon those types of grounds that it falls on, it either dies or it grows with patience and with time. And we see that we, as believers in Jesus Christ, as people, as creations of God Himself, we see that we are not always just one of these grounds, but our lives have the potential of ebbing and flowing, where Christ demands that we always be good soil. And so we just had a wonderful time of prayer and confession last week and asking ourselves, Lord, what type of soil are we? Are we bearing it with, are we bearing the word of God with patience, as verse 15 says, fruit with patience? And so this is the desire, as verse 15 says, that in order for us to be good soil, continuing with the kind of visual, in order for us to be good soil, we're called to hold fast to God's word with an honest and good heart and to bear fruit with patience. Patience tells us that faith in Christ, it takes time. It takes experience. It takes seasons of hardship and suffering for the fruit of righteousness to grow and to bloom and to mature. And it demands diligence to the word that we have received. And we saw such a great example of Jesus' diligence to ministry and to preaching in the very beginning of chapter 8. So we're going to continue in that explanation of the parable with our first section. Our first section this evening is Jesus's, it's his conclusive remarks on this application. And interestingly enough, he continues this application of the parable with really another kind of parabolic illustration. So let's take a look at that here in verse 16 through 18. He says this. He says, "No one after lighting a lamp covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand, so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Take care then how you hear, for to the one who has more, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks that he has will be taken away." We draw our remembrance now to that thought process that Jesus is explaining here, that the light, just as the seed is representative of the Word of God. It's the gospel of Christ. And if we are holding fast to it, as verse 15 tells us, then it should surround every portion of who we are. Just as you enter a dark room and you turn the light on, the light extinguishes the darkness. Even if you are just to light a small candle in a dark room, you would see that it reflects across the room and it ultimately enlightens all that is around it. It's interesting that researchers at Cornell University conducted an experiment of how far the human eye could detect a lit candle at night. Their conclusion was that a normal human eye has the capacity to see one candle, one flame from one candle, over 1.6 miles away in the midst of absolute darkness of night. One candle has the light to emanate over 1.6 miles away for us to be able to see it with the human eye. And that really is the entire purpose of light. I mean, we look at these lights up on the ceiling. We know that its purpose, light's purpose, is to illuminate. And it's exactly the same. It's a wonderful example of God's word. It illuminates all who we are to be, and it illuminates our purpose and of those around us. And we know that only in Christ, the entire reason that Christ has come upon this earth, as we see in our narrative, is he has come to shatter the darkness and to bring light to all men, as the prophecy proclaims. We know that without Christ, illumination, true clarity of our worth and our value and our purpose only comes from Christ. Illumination without him is impossible. Christ came as light to destroy the darkness. And so looking at verse 16, we must ask kind of two questions concerning this parable or concerning this illustration. Number one, what is the light concerning you and concerning me as believers? How does it affect us? How should it change us? Well, Paul, in his epistle to the Ephesians in chapter 4, verse 17, he says this. He says, "Now this I say, and I testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding. They are alienated from the life of God because the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greed, to practice every kind of impurity." Verse 20, this is wonderful. "But that is not the way you learn Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful desires. It is to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and in true holiness." This is how the light changes us. His light, his word, his character, his personhood. This is how Christ changes a sinner's life. And once we have it, we have a responsibility to use it. Once we are illuminated by Christ's light, we too become light as well to the rest of the world, to illuminate darknesses. And this is why he calls us, "You are the light of the world." As the Gospel of Matthew tells us in chapter 5, verse 16, he says, in the same way, he says, "Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Our purpose as being light to a dark and dying world is to declare the good works of Jesus Christ as the Holy Spirit's ministry in us and through us, and give glory to God the Father who is in heaven. And when people see that, when they see our example, our authentic, true reality of who we are, then that should change their viewpoint. They should see Christ in us. This is the utter definition of what it means to be a Christian, to be seen as having Christ residing in you and in me. And because of that, people are attracted to that. People desire to hear that gospel. They desire to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. And that's the first question. What is that light? How does it affect us? Second question we need to ask ourselves is, then how does the light then work and affect others in that same capacity? Well, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12 gives us an example, gives us an opportunity to see. He says, "Remember that you were at that time," talking about before you met Christ, "you were separated from him. You were not just separated from Christ, you were alienated from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world." That is the definition of all of humanity that does not know Christ. Separated, alienated, without promise, strangers, having no hope without God. What we once were, what you once were before you met Christ, outside of Christ revealing himself to us, we stood in utter, complete darkness. We were blind, as it were, to be able to see who he was and why we were created, and the wonderful gift of his own son given to us for us to have salvation. And because we now have the light, because we have now changed from being separated from Christ, now joined. We who were once alienated are now in the family of God. We who were once strangers are not strangers, we're friends of Jesus. We who once had no hope have eternal, permanent, perfect hope. Friends, you have a responsibility to now act on that word. And just as the title of our message says tonight, you have received this light. It is time for you to respond to that light. We have a responsibility to show the light of Christ to others. If not, what Jesus is saying here is absolutely true. If not, we are intentionally putting our light under a bed. I mean, just think about that for a second. Can you visualize that act in your mind? Doesn't it seem so just absolutely silly? Even a little bit crazy? How illogical it is to take a light and put it under a jar, and put it under a bed, and it totally defeats the purpose of the light in the first place. It denies its purpose. Friends, can I be as bold to tell you that if we are not light to this dark and dying world, we deny our very purpose? We deny who we were created to be? As sons and daughters of the light, sons and daughters of Jesus. I mean, you come to a friend's house, maybe they invite you to dinner, and it's friends that you've known for a long time, so you can feel at ease and vulnerable and honest, and you knock on their door, and maybe you've brought roses or flowers or something to give to them, and you enter in, and you walk into their living room, and as you walk through the living room into the kitchen, you kind of see light emanating from under their couch. And what's going to be your response? Be like, hey, I don't know if your kids, because I know my kids would do this. They took a flashlight and probably turned it on and then just rolled it under there. I mean, do you know that you have a flashlight on under your couch? And what if the response is like, no, we don't. No, we don't have a light under our couch. Don't worry about it. I made tri-tip. Come on over. Don't worry about that. I mean, it denies the purpose. It defeats the purpose. It's illogical. It's crazy. It's insane. But yet, friends, if I can, be honest with you, and we have this kind of dialogue to understand that there has been occasions where we have done this. We felt the sensitivity of the Holy Spirit to say, share the light of Christ to this person. Come alongside and put your arm around them. Ask how you can pray for them. Shed the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ to this person where they desperately need it. And we simply say, here's a jar. I don't want to deal with it. What is Jesus saying here? Jesus is telling us that we have a responsibility. If we've been granted the greatest gift known to all humanity, we also have a responsibility to share it. This is why verse 18 tells us then, says, take care. Take care. Pay attention how you hear. For the one who has more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. Isn't that a warning? Isn't that a caution? It's a warning of those who have heard the word, they've heard it, but they do nothing in response. They might even said, yes, I receive that word, but they do nothing in action to it. They've been given such a light, they've been given such a gift, and yet they refuse to open that gift, use it, to embrace it, to make it part of their identity, not just part, but to be their complete identity. They may have received, but they do not respond. And friends, that is such the culture of the day. We don't care that you're Christians. That's cool. That's fine. We don't care what you do at home or what you do in church, but don't you dare bring the light out into the public arena. Don't bring your light to the areas that people don't want your light. The culture tends to not only disregard our testimony, but tends to disregard the Word of God at all. And even if they do regard the Word of God, they simply place it within the mixture of all the other religious systems and tomes and spiritual books. Friends, I need to tell you, Scripture is distinctive. Did you know that? Scripture is unique. The Word of God is distinctive among all other religious texts. Why? Because no other religious text speaks of a God who does everything for us to receive salvation. All we simply do is receive and respond. No other religious system says, here's God, he does everything for you to give you salvation. He pays the sacrifice. He lives a perfect sinless life. He dies in excruciating pain. He faces the separation and judgment and wrath of God the Father himself. And he is resurrected having conquered over sin and death. He gives you everything. You just simply need to say yes. No other religious system except Christianity is able to say that. He did everything for your account. Scripture is distinctive. And you know what, friends? We should live as if it actually is distinctive. And you know, we can say these words. We can say, yes, I believe that. But so often we don't walk as if Scripture is unique and actually has power to come out of our voice. I mean, we don't understand when we speak the word of God, it comes with power because it comes with his authority, not ours. It comes with his strength, not ours. Scripture should be distinctive. If it isn't, then there's really no point in me reading any further. If Scripture is not unique to our desperate need of salvation, there is no point for us to continue services here ever again. We should close this up and go start a book club and read The Shack or some other goofy stuff. Scripture is what brings power. The Word of God is what brings peace. It brings grace. It is truly the means by which we can actually illuminate with the light of Christ to other people. We need to believe it to be what it says it is. Paul knew this. Paul, in his epistle to the Romans in chapter 10, he says this. He says, but what does it say? It says, the word is near you, it's in your mouth, and it's in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim because, and here's that famous quote, that famous text, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Here's the conclusion, for with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. Friends, the goal of Christ's shining light is to turn you into shining lights. That's his goal. We are the light of the world. And being the light of the world, it can only come from hearing and believing God's word. Without God's word, we are futile. This is why I just do not get it that there are churches today in our modern context that so desperately need to preach the word of God and they preach some other fluffy stuff. We need God's word for our sustenance. And this is why he says, if you are following in this light, if you actually bring this light out with the responsibility of sharing it, then guess what? He says, you're part of me. You do what I do because I reside within you. You're part of who I am. I mean, this is where the text is impacted and emphasized. Look at verse 19 through 21. It says, then, you know, kind of the narrative switches a little bit. It's kind of as if he's praying. It's you know, you're panning the visual out of your mind, and it's panning out of the crowd. And there it says, his mother and his brothers came to him, verse 19, but they could not reach him because of the crowd. And he was told, your mother and your brothers, they're standing outside desiring to see you. As if to say, you know, they deserve some special treatment. They're your blood, right? Look at Jesus' response. He answers to them. He says, my mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it. Those who hear the word of God and do it. I mean, let's just take a step back and I mean, obviously this portion of the text is controversial in many ways. Number one, it actually speaks of him, Jesus, having brothers. Uh-oh. What does that mean? I mean, to some people, this is a controversial subject, especially concerning the perpetual virginity of Mary. And really, friends, there's no other way to translate the Greek of Luke's gospel in this text any other way but to simply say they were his brothers. I mean, it's interesting, all throughout the centuries, such a small text has been sought to be dispelled. There's a heretic in the first century named Marcion. And he was a heretic because he believed that Jesus was divine, but he was not human. He believed that he was the Logos. He believed that he is God in divinity, but he did not believe Hebrews 4:15, that he was sympathetic to our weakness because he suffered every temptation. And when he translated the Gospel of Luke and the public was able to grasp the Gospel of Luke, they open up to chapter, they didn't have chapters, but you know what I mean. They open up to the text and verse 19 is not there. What happened? Well, it's just simply pick that up because it doesn't follow into, you know, my worldview. If Scripture is powerful enough to grasp the very voice of God for the Holy Spirit and his wonderful inspiration through these writers, we need to follow every jot and every tittle that it says. And look at Jesus' response. I won't go any further with that tangent. Look at Jesus' response. Doesn't it seem somewhat harsh? A little bit rude, maybe? It seems harsh, but friends, not in comparison, not in light of the understanding of the eternal weight of his words that he just spoke previously. Those who do not obey the word of God have no relationship with God, and thus have no relationship with Christ. I mean, do we see the emphasis that Christ places on his word? He says, those who are in the light are those who hear and do. Those who receive and respond. Those who confess and those who believe. Those who are in the light are those who hear and do his word. He says, these people, they are my family. Friends, his attention is only upon those who are willing to hear his word and receive it and obey. And this is so wonderful, because this is the almighty power of the gospel to change us as sinners. Because friends, it's so true. We just read previously in Ephesians, we were orphans. We have no family if we do not have Christ. As sinners relying on darkness to be our sustenance, we had no one to bring us any type of hope. We had no unity. We had no understanding of what love ever meant. This is the world. Christ says, if you would only come, if you would only receive, if you would only respond, you are guaranteed a family that I am gathering together. You are guaranteed a kingdom that I bring. You can be a part of a family of sinners under the banner of Jesus Christ, moving us, progressing us in faithfulness and truth. That's a pretty prominent statement, verse 21. Those who hear, my mother and my brothers, are those who hear the word of God and do it. They hear and they do. That's my heart's desire. I might be distracted by all that's going on in the week and the obligations that are demanding my attention in the things that I would love to do while being in the presence of the things that I have to do, in the responsibilities that God has given me that are a privilege and an encouragement, and knowing how to fit that in the time of being with my family and all of these things, that it can be so demanding and distracting and confusing, and all that I want to do is find freedom. Friends, freedom is this. It can breed this one statement that defines our life. We hear the word of God and we do it. We do not just want to be hearers. We want to be doers of God's word. And so the question we must ask ourselves is then, what does hearing God's word and doing it sound like? You know, can we have an example of how this works? How is it expressed? Well, I don't want to say this, but I must because I really believe it to be the truth. The ability to hear God's word and to do it, friends, often, more often than not, that happens in times of trial and suffering. Not in the times of ease and comfort, but in the moments where you suffer and you remember the word of God that you daily looked at up to this point. It's as if you're not looking at Scripture as simply a remedy to your issues, but also as the preventative measure of being able to look at the world and face it with all its obstacles, evils, and iniquity. And have the capacity to say, in me resides the light of Christ, and I am stable through trial and through suffering because I know what the Word of God says about trials and suffering. Even greater, I know what the Word of God says about Jesus, and I know what the Word of God says about me when I reside in Him. I know what the Word of God says about the ministry of the Holy Spirit, how He's the great comforter in not just my time of need, not just in my famine, but in my feast. So I truly believe, as the gospel writer Luke, he wants to give us an example. Well, here's an example, verse 22 through 25. Then he says, one day, he got into a boat with his disciples and he said to them, let us go across to the other side of the lake. So they set out. And as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake and they were filling with water. And they were in danger. And they went and they woke him saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. And he awoke. And he rebuked the wind and the raging waves, and they ceased. And there was a calm. And he said to them, where is your faith? And they were afraid, and they marveled, saying to one another, who then is this, that he commands even winds and waters, and they obey him? Can we just jump into the narrative just for a second? You know, Jesus, you know, in such a beautiful way, he has these companions, he has these intimate 12, and they are fishermen, they're experienced sailors. And he says, let's go across the lake, you know, let's do some ministry on the other side. And they're like, great. And so they set out. And as they sailed, it says, verse 23, he fell asleep. I mean, let's just stop there for a moment, just a second. Jesus gets tired. He gets weary, and he falls asleep. God incarnate, God with flesh on, perfect deity, was tired and needed rest. He walked this earth needing food, drink, and rest. Luke is so specific. And I love this about Luke because, you know, he spends a good amount of time of talking about occasions where Jesus is hanging out and he's just eating with people. I love that. He's fellowshipping with people. And it says here that he's tired, and so he is sleeping, and it just shows this wonderful hypostatic union of humanity and deity together in this wonderful example. Because what happens? A windstorm erupts. You know, some translations talk that it was even to the point of being a typhoon. And this boat starts to take on water. And friends, what is happening here? You know, look at it for a second. Automatically, a place of believing, a place of doing that which you were taught to do in an environment of suffering and even potential death is brought upon the occasion of these disciples. Here's the opportunity. Here's the opportunity, the privilege of finding their solace in Christ. And this is what they do. They wake him crying out, "We are perishing." Have you ever said those words in a prayer before? God, there's nothing that you can say right now. I feel like I'm dying. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, whatever. That's enough for Christ to respond. His attention is on us. We are perishing. There's no thought of salvation in their eyes except looking at Christ as their last resort. These are experienced fishermen. They probably went through every, structure. If I do this, if I, tie this down, if I bring this over, if we batten these hatches, I don't know. If we, correlate, I don't know, maybe we can survive. And they just relinquish. They finalize every possible outcome. And at the end of it, we're just taking on water. We're going to die. The only thing we can go to now is Christ. I come to Christ. We're perishing. Master, you must act. Okay, I want to stop here. Before we get into Jesus' words, we need to stop here. I want you to jump into the Old Testament. I want you to look at Psalm 29, verse 3 and 4. You know what? Don't even change. Don't even turn. Let's just close our eyes for a moment and listen to what Scripture, the Word of God, has to say. I'm going to read to you three Psalms. Psalm 29, it says, "The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty." Psalm 104, "He lays the beams of his chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind." Psalm 107, "Some went down to the sea in ships doing business on the great waters. They saw the deeds of the Lord, his wondrous works in the deep. For he commanded and raised the stormy wind which lifted up the waves of the sea. They mounted up to heaven. They went down to their depths. Their courage melted away in their evil plight. They reeled, they staggered like drunken men. They were at their wits' end. Then they cried the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed. Then they were glad that the waters were quiet, and he brought them to their desired haven. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, his wondrous works to the children of man." Sons and daughters of Christ, those who know God's word, believe. Those who will believe God's word are able to trust his word. Those who are able to trust his word, they are assured of his promises. Those who are assured of his promises are confident. And those who are confident are stable, no matter what environment they are in. The same man who sleeps is the same God who makes the clouds his chariot. This is why he's able to awake, and he rebukes the wind and the raging waves. That word rebuke is a special word. It's not a human word. It's not something a human is able to do outside of God's working, because this word rebuke is God's words himself as a command. It's God's word in commanding. We don't have the authority. We don't have the ability to say, "With my authority, I rebuke these things." No, it comes from God's authority. He is the one that able to calm the seas and the winds. And it's through his rebuke that we have power through his word. And what happens? The storm becomes still. It says there was ceased and then there was calm. It's as if the raging waves are now just this glass and the clouds have parted. And I love this question from Jesus because it's not a condemning question. It's an evaluating question that's for every single one of us here. He saves them first. And then he says, where is your faith? I love that. What if they woke him up and said, Jesus, Master, we're perishing. And he says, where's your faith? And then goes back to sleep. I don't know, it's somewhere on the shore or something. We need help. He calms, he stabilizes, and then he says, where is your faith? Where is your faith? They were afraid and they marveled, saying to one another, who then is this that he commands even winds and water, and they obey him? They were afraid and they marveled. Because were they afraid and marveled at the storm? Yeah, initially. But that's not what the text tells us here. What are they afraid of now? What are they marveling at now? It's the Son of God who's in their boat with them. And I kind of wonder, I put myself in the disciples' place. And I'm trying to walk by faith. I'm in the midst of this man who is just so different than any other man. He teaches with an authority that I've never heard before. He heals the sick. And every single time I'm placed at a quandary and to be able to, you know, is that even real? I mean, did he pay this guy 3 days ago to say, I'm healed and that was it? Or, you know, he raised this person from the dead. Well, it's possible that he could somehow manipulate this person in sleeping and hypnosis or something to that effect. I don't know. There's all these things, and I'm walking by faith. I want to believe, but I have these doubts. No one can conjure the storm and have this man say, be calm, and it becomes calm. Christ illuminates himself. He reveals himself in just one more way before these disciples. And I think that is what makes them afraid and marvels. Friends, there's nothing like going through a season of suffering and hardship, and you have no means of recourse but to fall on the knees of Jesus Christ and say, Lord, I'm perishing. What are you going to do? Do something, and he shines forth. And my response is to be, I'm in awe. Not only is this the affirmation of who you are, Jesus, but in this suffering, in this trial, this is also the affirmation of who I am in you. I will not falter. I will not fail because I stand on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. I stand upon the rock. I'm not upon the sand. I am able to be a light in the darkness because I come not with my own authority. I come with his authority. I come with his words, not my words. I come with his peace that only comes from him, that even passes all understanding. I know what love is. I have the responsibility then to not only marvel at Christ, worship him, be in awe and fear, reverence before the God of my creation, of who I am, but also to live as his child and to illuminate this dark and dying world. What do we say to all this? We need to receive, but we also need to respond.